within the world of multi-sport and endurance and ultra endurance, I mean, everybody knows who you are. They know your accomplishments. But there's a lot of people that listen to this that don't necessarily come from that world. But perhaps they became familiar with you because of the Everest expedition that you went on in 2017. So can we talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that made headlines across the world. In a 5 or 6 day period, you summited twice. And so the first attempt, you decide to start at like 5,100 meters, right?
Yeah.
Which is lower than where most people start.
Yeah, normally.
Like at the temple, right?
Yeah, normally people like start from the final push that it takes a few days from ABC, Advanced Base Camp, that's at the feet of the mountain at 6,300 meters. But actually, to get there, it's a long, long hike. It's like maybe 13 miles. And from Rombuk, it's where the road ends. Like, it's a road that finished there. So I wanted to, like, the goal of the whole expedition, it was not to set a FKT in the mountain, because, like, it's, you cannot talk about FKT in these high mountains because conditions and style make huge difference. Mm-hmm. So it was mostly to try to go from the last village to the summit and back, and only with my means, like carrying all the gear I needed and not having any assistance, because then I wanted to know if I was able to climb the mountain by myself or if I wasn't.
And all right, so the first attempt from 5,100 meters, you make it to the summit. And back down 26 hours.
Up 26 hours.
Okay. Yeah. And no ropes, no supplemental oxygen. Unbelievable. Like, what was the hardest part of that for you?
The hardest thing in the first descent is that I feel like I had stomach problems.
Yeah, you ate something bad.
Yeah,
right?
I eat something bad probably the day before, in the base camp. So at the beginning I was feeling okay for a few hours, but then I started to have diarrhea and vomiting. So I decided to stop eating to avoid that. But then energy goes low. So during the last hours to the summit, it was very, very slow. And it's not like... it's not hard in a way that up there, it's more only two decisions. Like, you are saying, okay, is this going to kill me? And if it's yes, then you turn. Mm-hmm. And if it's no, then you continue. So,
but
was
suffering. But why not bail when your stomach's turning on you and say, look, I'll just do this, I'll go reboot and do it again another day? That decision to continue, were you too far into it? Or what was the decision to persist?
Yeah, mostly it's it's very long, from Rombuk until you get to the mountains. Like, it's these 13 miles in the moraine. It's painful, it's not fun. So then I was there and I was almost when I decided, okay, now it will be hard.
I was at
8,000 meters. So he's okay, should I go all the way back and start it again, a couple of days or I'm here. I will go slow, but I will not die. And somehow it will be some fun. Uh-huh. So why not to continue? And yeah.
Fun for you.
Yeah. It's a special fun. Yeah.
Yeah. So you do that, but then I presume because of that stomach illness or a sense of knowing that you could do it faster or better, you make this decision to go once again.
Yeah, it was funny. I was going down from the first summit, and during the downhill, I was thinking, okay, we still have 5 days till the plane leaves from Lhasa to home. So we had some extra days in the base camp. It's nothing to do in the base camp. So instead of packing during 1 week, it was I was thinking, okay, why not to try to go up again? Not for the doing a fast time, because I knew that I will be very tired, mm-hmm, after this first ascent. But also it started to interest, if it would be possible to recover fast and to see how the recovery affects and to see if it if it was possible.
Yeah, and from what I understand, as you know, being somebody who's never attempted anything like that, but people who really understand this, that's the most miraculous aspect of all of this, which is that it generally takes somebody weeks to kind of recover from an experience like that before they're prepared or physiologically ready to attempt another summit. But just literally days later, you decide to go again. And I think it speaks to your natural ability to recover more quickly than the average human being on some level. But also, like, what is that like? Did you just felt like internally you did a gut check and you're like, I'll be fine. I feel good.
Yeah, I think it was, I felt okay. Like, you feel tired, but it's like, okay, yeah, I can move. So, but mostly I think the recovery, it's because we hadn't been long in the mountain. So like, as I said before, like with the fast, acclimatization and with the, being like short travels, like we were there and I was still fresh on kind of like motivation and like healthy, like strong. And in the other side, like I never slept high in the mountain. Like all the nights I spent, it was always maximum, it was 6,300 meters. So like not sleeping high, it makes a big impact for the recovery. Then you need to be able to go to the summit, like from, so do a long elevation from 6,000 meters. So it's very long days, but it's good nights.
Uh-huh.
So that makes also good for recovery. And yeah, like during the second ascent, like I was feeling tired, like normally, but I think it was better than what I expected. Like I was able to kind of walk.
That second time up, the conditions were worse, right? There was snowing and windier.
Yeah, it was supposed to be the best day in the summer or in the spring. Like all the like big groups, like Adrian Belinger, they were climbing that day. Also, like the Swiss expedition, Cary Cobbler, they were climbing this day. So they were saying that's the day. It's marked to be the best one on the season. So I was saying, okay, that's cool, yeah. And then we started climbing, and the bad weather was coming faster than supposed. And because I didn't have any radio or any kind of communication with the others, they could not tell me. Mm-hmm. And then, like, I saw, like, it was okay, the sky is a bit more white, but it was windy, but not that bad. Like it's not wind that it throws you away the face. Right. So yeah.
Right. And so you summit, and this time you started from advanced base camp, right? So that was like 6,500.
Yeah. So this time. Yeah. Actually after the first summit, I was going down to the base camp. Then actually we
you got lost.
The second time, but after the first time, like we were packing everything to get ready for leaving Lhasa, because I knew, okay, if I go back to the summit, like it will be super speed after.
Uh-huh.
So we pack everything, and then we went up to ABC to 1600. Mm-hmm. And then we didn't have any tent there, but it was Alpenglow that they had an expedition there, and they were up in the mountain, so we could sleep in their dining room.
Right.
And then I started from there. And yeah, then going down, I get lost from the mountain. That was kind of fun.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, and you end up perilously close to that North Face that ridge, right? The drop off.
Yeah, it was. It was strange. Like I think like now, like I has been talking with a lot of doctors and start to understand why I had a blackout period during a few minutes. So actually I was climbing and it was fine. It was windy. So like the tracks and it was covered. Like even like in spring climbing, you cannot talk about alpine style, because even if I wasn't using the fixed ropes, like it's the second leather or the third leather in the second step that I use it, and then it's the fixed ropes there. So like even if you don't use it, like it's easy to follow the way because they are there. But during the second ascent, with all the bad weather, like it was snowing a lot and windy, so all the ropes and all the tracks were covered. But that was okay. And in the way down, I remember very well, like until I reached the 8,300 meters. But from there, I have like a blackout period. I don't know what it happened. And
like, the next you don't know how you got there. Like I think you said, you thought you were going to wake up from a dream and be at base camp.
Yeah, because from there, like the next memory was like I was down climbing something technical in a big face. I was not anymore in a ridge where I was supposed to be, but in a big face, snowy, rocky. It's like, where I am, what I'm doing here. It's this dream because I didn't have any connection with the last memory, so I didn't know if it was reality or if it was a bad dream and I was going to wake up in the base camp. And yeah, the bad or the worst thing, it was like I didn't know where I was, so I didn't know if I was in the northeast face or in the north face or in the south face. So it was like, okay, it's in the middle of the night, it's bad weather, I'm in a phase and I have no, absolutely no idea where
I am. So how do you keep it together? How do you avoid panicking? How do you avoid, you know, your emotions getting the best of you when you're in a moment like that?
Yeah, I think that's what you need to prepare for and to feel, as I said before, feel confident in situations that you are not supposed to be confident and to be comfortable. It's exactly these kind of situations. And I think it's just to really accept and to mentally accept before going to an expedition what you can find there and to not be surprised when these situations arrive because they are possible. And I think when I was there, it was like, it was more like a checking saying, okay, I am cold. No, I will not die because I will have like frostbite or like hypothermia. Mm-hmm. I didn't feel any edema, like a brain edema or lung edema. So I was saying, okay, this is okay, this is okay. The only problem is that the night, and I don't know where it is, but I will not die because it's night and I will not die because I don't know where I am. So then it was like, okay, I just need to figure out these two things. Like the night is this, like you wait until it's daylight so you can see where you are. And then it was mostly to know that. And I was physically feeling good, so I was thinking, okay, I'm at 8,000 meters. At that time, I was between 8,200 and 8,000 meters. I was thinking, okay, if I'm by, I don't know how, in the south face, and I need to climb up again to 8,500, it will be hard, but I feel like physically okay to doing it, so I wasn't afraid of, like, need to go up again or to... Yeah,
right. So just like really to compartmentalize all of these things and be as logical as possible and not let your emotions or any fear creep into how you're making those decisions.
Yeah, I think emotions up in high mountains are dangerous and it can be fear. Like if you panic in a situation like that, probably you do mistakes and then you fall. But also like euphoria, like if you are summiting and in the summit, like you start to have like adrenaline and you start to feel, wow, that's done and like excitement, then probably during the downhill, like you will do mistakes because you don't take care. So I think both good and bad emotions up there, like any emotion is bad in a, in normal,
So that's something I would imagine you've just learned over the many years of just always being in the mountains and being in, you know, countless situations where risk was a huge factor.
Yeah, we learn a lot of mistakes, I would say, and doing mistakes, having accidents or doing stupid things, we all do. And these situations that you, when you come home, it's like, wow, today it was very, very stupid. And it's there when you learn, when you say, okay, next time I need to do better.
Yeah, and your adventures have not been without some consequences to some loved ones. I mean, I know you were out with Emily, and, you know, outside Chamonix, and you had to be rescued, and you've lost a couple friends. So I would imagine that, does that weigh on you when you're out there?
Sure. Like, we do an activity that we know that it's possibly, like, we can die there in the mountain. and it's nothing that we look. We are not doing that because we are close to death, but because we are alive when we're doing. But it's the possibility of an accident, and when you have some close calls, it can be like some friends that they die by your side, or it can be like some accidents. But all the times, I think it's funny that when you start to do mountaineering, like, you are afraid about your capacities because you don't know yourself, but you see the mountain as something solid, that it's there, it's like a ball or it's something. And more you go into the mountains, less you are afraid about yourself, but you know better your capacities, your technique, your experience. But you see that the mountain, it's moving, and it's dangerous there that you don't see, but they are there. So you are more afraid about the mountain. So it's this thing that, it's many things that you cannot control. Like, you can think logically, but then avalanches come where it's supposed to not, or like some rock fallings and things. And you need to accept in a way that that's part of it, that it's many things we can control, but it's some of them that is not possible to do.